Welcome to Oxford. We're just making a start on this Mitraclip case. Let me start by introducing the team. Operating with me, I have Adrian Banning. Our anaesthetic team are Maurizio, Rashmi and Claudia. Interventional imaging is Jim Newton. The cath lab team is Paul, Lauren, Stuart, Jersey, Heidi and Pedro. The AV team, Chris and Jim. And from Abbott, we're being supported by Will Winder. So you've seen the case background. Let's have a look at the TOE images. Let's go over to you, Jim.
So I'm going to start with a four-chamber image, which, as you can see, demonstrates a reasonable left ventricle. It's not as vigorous as you'd expect in somebody with such a degree of mitral regurgitation. The right ventricular function, however, is poor, and this man has very, very severe mitral regurgitation, as you can see on colour Doppler, with a broad jet right up to the back of his dilated left atrium. In terms of the mechanism for the mitral regurgitation, I'll show you in the bicommissural view, which we'll be using for most of the procedure. This is the anterior leaflet here, A2. This is P1 and this is P3. And you can see the leaflets are tented towards the apex. They're not reaching the annular plane. The annulus is dilated, measuring 46 millimetres in this view and 38 in the three-chamber view. And you can see there's very broad mitral regurgitation across the whole face of A2, although the dominant side is perhaps this corner here, which is the posteromedial commissure rather than the anterolateral, and that's secondary to tenting of the posterior leaflet because of shortened cordae. There's no prolapse or flail, but perhaps you can appreciate in this view the posterior leaflet is very tethered, pulled down, as is the tip of the anterior leaflet. The whole valve is tented and the mitral regurgitation is through the centre of the valve. He has no other valvular abnormalities. He has clear flow reversal in both his pulmonary veins, compatible with severe MR. We'll be monitoring that during the case to see if that improves post-clip. And he has on table moderate tricuspid regurgitation with a peak velocity of around 3 meters per second, secondary to his mitral regurgitation.
So as Jim says, the way we do this is we tend to explain through the bicommissural view to get the LVOT view, and that is how we do most of this procedure. What I can see is that there's a pretty broad jet. It's worse on the medial side, so that's the left of the left-hand image. And I think it's pretty broad jet. I think we're going to need more than one clip. Generally speaking, it's easier to clip from medial to lateral rather than lateral to medial. So I think probably what I'll try and do is get the larger version of the clip, the XTR, on the medial side of the jet. What we will try and do is leave not too much residual mitral regurgitation medially so that we can then clip on the medial side and then add another clip or two on the lateral side to try and reduce his MR. It's worth saying that this man has torrential MR, so it would be nice if we got mild or less MR, but I would be very happy if we got moderate, and I think he would feel very different if we did that.
But your expectation is this will be a couple of clips?
I don't think it'll be one, no. So we now have an SL0 catheter and a bayless needle in the SVC. Understart coming down. What we want to be is posterior and inferior. The views that you can see on the TOE are, on the left we're looking at superior inferior with superior on the right, and on the right we're looking at AP with anterior on the right. So his septum has had some ablations before, so it is going to be more scarred, which is why bayless is quite useful here, I think. So it's coming down nicely. It's looking not bad in the AP.
Yeah, nice plane. And posterior there.
And I'm just inching it down.
Should we just have a measure there, Sam?
It's nice and posterior. Good, so I'm happy with that. So it's really important to get this in the right place because it's the difference between a straightforward procedure and an extremely complicated procedure, so it is worth spending an extra minute or two on it. So I'm just getting the bayless needle out of the tip of the catheter. Okay, Heidi, we're ready to ablate. Okay, yep.
Okay, that's across.
Across. So I'm going to advance everything together, then the dilator and the sheath by itself. And then the dilator alone. Okay, so this is the Mitraclip guide. We have the Mitraclip step here, which just puts the device at the right height and at the right distance away from the patient. And we have the stabilizer as well. So when we're putting the Mitraclip into the patient, we tend to turn the guide to minus, because that straightens it out and makes it as straight as possible. As we come up to the septum, I'm just going to take off the minus to return the bend to the tip of the guide. Then we're going to steer across the septum. I'm going to advance a bit of dilator just to make it a slightly more tapered crossing. So I'm watching on mostly TOE now. You can see the tapered part of the dilator coming through. So we're now advancing the Mitraclip delivery system. So the clip delivery system is now advanced into the left atrium. We know that we're likely to get stuck on the Coumadin ridge, so I'll be aware of that as we start to turn the M knob to flex down towards the mitral valve. Usually it's flexion with the M knob and posterior torque. We're now positioning using the BICOM view and the LVOT view. I'm positioning above the mitral valve. So that looks pretty lateral to me.
Lateral and posterior at the moment, yeah.
What we'll do now is see if the clip is oriented appropriately. Usually it needs some fine tuning at this point, so we'll go into a 3D on fast view.
So the objective is to be 12 o'clock, 6 o'clock.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It depends. If you're going very commissural, you try and be 90 degrees to the commissure. But yes, for what we're doing now, it's 12 and 6 o'clock. What I want to do also is make sure that there's no torque stored in the device. So I'm just trying to release that now, because otherwise it can move a little bit unpredictably as you cross the valve. So I think that's probably not a bad place to start. We want to be possibly a little more medial than that. So
I'll just maybe just a little bit, yeah.
There. And then we'll do our fine tuning in the bicommissural LVOT views. So now we're happy with the clip orientation. It's the first clip, so you can easily cross the valve open. You don't need to close to cross the valve. What we are going to do now is put colour on and see whether we're splitting the jet. And what we want to be is probably just on the medial side of the jet. To me, I think that's probably a bit too medial, but we'll...
Yeah, most of the jet is have a think coming alongside.
So what I don't want to do is leave a big medial jet. So to move more lateral, all I'm going to do is advance the whole clip like that. Okay, so let's cross the valve. So same views. So we're now under the valve. I'll get a little closer to the valve just so we can see it, but let's recheck the orientation now.
Okay, coming up now. So I'm just going to recreate that same view with the aorta at the top. Just going to turn the gain right down so we can see through the valve.
That's beautiful,
good.
Jim.
Yeah, for the medial side, you want to be sort of 11:30, 5:30, so I think that's pretty good. So now I think we're ready to grasp. So as you see in the right-hand image, that's our grasping view. I'm going to close the clip to probably a little bit too open there. I'll close it to 120 or so. And now I'm just going to retract.
Both are on there, that's good.
So with this version of the clip, you need to resist the temptation of pulling back too much. It's actually better if you don't close under tension. So I've closed a tiny bit, so let's just go back to we'll go back to the 3D on fast view and just see if we're happy with the orientation, because it's easy to change this now. Are we ready to close the clip? So as we do that, we're watching the left atrial pressure, and it's come down nicely. Gives us a clue that we've made a difference to the MR. So now we're going to assess.
The MR that's remaining is over on the well lateral to the clip, which is what we want. Let's check a gradient. Mean of 5.
So what we're seeing here is so far looking pretty promising. We have very little left on the medial side. We have a residual lateral jet, which we're planning to fix in a second. The thing that is notable is that the lateral jet is a little separate from the first clip, so we'd be a bit more tricky to treat, but we'll work out a way of doing that in just a second.
So I would have thought that would be better, that you've got a bit of space, but that's not better.
Well, if it's close, you can get very close with the other clip and it's not going to have much impact on gradient.
Oh, I see.
If it's far away, you run the risk of leaving yourself with a jet between the clips, which you can't reach.
Right.
And also that you push up the gradient.
Right. So you end up with a three-hole orifice,
yeah,
which is not very big. Yeah.
Okay. The thing to say, though, that the gradient tends not to change very much between clip one and two.
Okay.
I'm not sure I know why that is, but it tends not to. So to release the clip, the grippers are down, the lock lever is down. I've checked that the clip is fully closed. Now what I'm going to do is test the lock. So I'm going to open the clip, or try and open the clip, and it does not unlock, which tells us that the lock is working. Move back to neutral, half a turn clockwise. So this is the gripper line. I'm just making sure that when I pull it, the line moves freely without too much resistance. So that's moving nicely. Now I can remove the lock line, pull the grenade pin, expose the groove, and then 8 or 9 turns. I'll now let go of the clip.
That's nicely off.
So you can see that that's released. The grip line is still attached, so we can still retrieve the clip if we need to. So if you look, the key point here is that the clip is very stable. It's moving with the heart, but it's not moving any more than that. So I am very happy with that. As we pull the gripper line, we're just watching to make sure that we're not moving the clip too much. So the clip's now released. So what we're going to do now is we'll just check how much guide we have across the septum.
You have plenty.
And now I'm going to undo all those movements I did before and then get this clip delivery system out. So I'm going to take off the M, I'm going to remove the posterior torque.
Just looking at the pulmonary vein flow at the moment. This is the right upper pulmonary vein. This is colour. I have Doppler here, and the key thing is how much forward flow there is in systole. This is systole here. So we've got a clear S wave appearing. If I come to the left upper pulmonary vein, it's even better. That's the left upper there. Again, you can see on colour that in systole there's good brisk red forward flow. And on pulmonary vein Doppler, again, there's a nice S wave visible here, so we've dramatically improved the pulmonary vein Doppler. Taking a look at the valve, we can see the clip is where we positioned it on the medial aspects of A2 and P2. The residual colour is predominantly lateral to that, just adjacent to and alongside A2 next to the clip. And we'll check a gradient. Obviously, we don't want to cause important stenosis. So just continuous wave through the orifice. He's an AF, so we'll do some averages. We've had 3 of 5 already. Stay on the spectral envelope, and we've got 6 there. So an acceptable gradient at this stage.
So talk us through what you're thinking, Sam.
So just thinking through our strategy for the next clip. So we've already had a big impact on his MR. He will feel better from this, but I think we can do better. He has 2 residual jets, both lateral to the first clip, and they have a gap between them. I think the most lateral jet, so the most the rightmost jet on the screen is the worst one. But I don't want to put the clips that far apart because I think that might have a negative impact on the gradient. I think it'll cause mitral stenosis. So I think what I'm going to do is aim just the lateral side of that medial jet and hope that the XTR with the longer clip arms will pull everything together sufficiently to handle both jets.
My ventricle looks a bit happier to me, Jim.
About to say the same thing. It's always eye of faith, isn't it? And tempting, but I think there's definitely a little bit more contraction.
I think so.
I'll just go back and play the original picture of that just so we can be sure. That's where we started.
Yeah, it definitely does. Yeah.
And that's where we are now. I dare say it's even come down in size a little bit, which
I think it has. Yeah,
just shows you the acute physiology.
The patients tolerate this procedure very well, seemingly.
Yeah, it's a very hemodynamically benign procedure. The only thing that happens really is the blood pressure goes up a bit as you close the clip. Good. And now, as before, it's mostly M and posterior torque. Feels like we're stuck, Jim.
Yeah, we just caught on the ridge there.
Very often you catch the Coumadin ridge, and you can see there that just by pulling everything back, suddenly everything's free. And as long as you're aware of that, it's very easy to fix generally. So I'm just going to position over the valve. So just give us colour there, Jim. That's kind of where we were talking about, isn't it? It's just to the right of the medial jet. So let's orient the clip. When there's already a clip in there, you have to close the clip across the valve, just so you don't interact, especially with this device, with the XTR, with the longer clip arms. 3D on fast, please. So now over the valve on fluoroscopy, I can see I'm not interacting with the other clip. So I'm just going to clock. Again, we want to be 12 and 6-ish. You can see I'm just talking anteriorly there. When you're in the left atrium, it moves very easily. So that's sort of 12 and 6, pretty much parallel with the other clip, which I think is a nice position to be in. So I'm going to close the clip. Just wonder whether we want to be fraction. On fluoro, it looks like we're quite far away, but on TOE,
it looks okay. Yeah.
Like we're quite close. So I think that's fine. So I'm just going to very carefully come across, correcting the AP direction as needed. Don't think we're diving one way or the other. No, as you see on fluoroscopy, they're absolutely parallel and they're not interacting. Make sure I'm properly under the valve.
Nice.
And now we can open again. It's not too bad. Might clock a fraction.
So Jim, that's the previous clip on the right-hand side there, isn't it?
Yeah, this is the first clip. This is the new clip. The gain's deliberately down, otherwise you can't see much through the valve leaflets.
And the colour seems to be about right, doesn't it?
Splitting the colour.
Pretty much splitting it, aren't we? So as I come up, I will do this with fluoroscopy as well, just to make sure that we're not interacting with the other clip, which we're not.
Definitely on there.
Just going to try and get a bit more posterior. Here it's important to resist the temptation to pull up too much, because if you do, you'll get more of a gradient, I think. So I've started to close. So Jim, just show us the 3D on fast. So that looks pretty good.
Yeah, it's nice, isn't it? I mean, you're sort of closer to the anterior side than the posterior side, but that's no bad thing, I guess.
So I'm just going to gently close and release the tension as I do. The pressure has come down a little bit, so let's just reassess there.
Yeah, I was going to save that. Okay, so again, further improvements in the MR. There's really no significant jet getting to the mid atrium. Just there.
You can see almost laminar flow in the left atrium, can't you? It's
just a tiny spray around the lateral corner of that second clip.
I think so far that looks nice. Check the gradient. We'll do the full assessment. If there's an issue with gradient, there are various tricks. You can not lift up quite so much when you close the clip. You could use an XTR. An NTR. You could get closer to the other clip. So there are various things we can do. But he's now running at 100, so this is not physiological heart rate for him. And his gradient is 6, which is
just going to do a dust couple of those. Fine. I look how the orifices look on 3D. So you can see we have favoured this side of A2 and P2. The medial orifice is slightly smaller by than the lateral orifice, but they're pretty close to each other.
Yeah, so we started with flow reversal. We then went to D-dominant. We're still D-dominant, but the S-wave is increasing in size.
Yeah, we've got a good S-wave here, yeah. Two-thirds of the size of D now.
So we have reduced the mitral regurgitation from torrential to probably mild or mild to moderate.
This is mild.
Mild, okay, I'll take that. without a significant increase in gradient or a gradient that would cause us any concern. I think I'm pretty happy with that. So testing the lot one more time, which looks good. Okay, so let's just release this clip. As you can see, very nice and stable.
So I'm going to have a look at the biochemical review. As before, both clips are lovely and parallel and nice and stable. And we have just that very small residual spray of MR just alongside the lateral border of the second clip. So nothing new or different.
That's a percutaneous mitral repair for this man with torrential mitral regurgitation, who is at very high risk for redo surgery. We've seen a reduction in the MR from torrential to probably mild. Interestingly, we can also see his right ventricle is looking better than it was before. He'll go back to the ward. He doesn't need to go to the intensive care unit. We'll close the single per close here, and most of these patients go home the following day.
Very nice.